Hello from Charleston, South Carolina, and welcome to the Public Forums, an event planning toolkit for communities concurrent session. I'm Nikki Seibert-Kelly, owner of Whip Meets Grit, a food system consulting firm helping organizations realize their mission. I am also the South Carolina Food Hub Network facilitator and a proud member of the South Carolina Food Policy Council. My work in the food system has shown me the importance and the power of building cross-sector networks focused on a collaborative and inclusive approach to addressing the needs of the community. Today's session digs deeper into the power of networks through the lens of food policy councils in the Carolinas. With the support of the City of Columbia, the Columbia Food Policy Committee addresses food insecurity and food systems issues through policies that support increased access to healthy food for underserved populations. Before the pandemic hit, the committee had created a new toolkit for food councils and community groups, as well as hosting community-led public forums to create community engagement and buy-in, and to highlight community food system issues. Not only will you hear about the Columbia Food Policy Committee's work, but also about food policy councils in North Carolina. Today's speakers are Jared Cates with the Carolina Farm Stewardship Association, Ashley Page Bookhart and Zach Hernstadt with the University of South Carolina Arnold School of Public Health SNAP Ed Program, and the Columbia Food Policy Committee. I hope you enjoy learning more about food policy councils and their power to facilitate change in our food systems. Enjoy the session.
Thanks so much for that introduction. I'm going to go ahead and share my screen. Hey y'all, I am Jared Cates with the Carolina Farm Stewardship Association and with the Community Food Strategies team. And as you heard, I'm joined by Zach Hernstadt and Ashley Page Bookhart, both with the USC Department of Health Promotion, Education and Behavior. And we're excited to chat with you today about a new toolkit that we just wrapped up just in time for this session called Community Food Gatherings, a public forum planning toolkit for communities. So in this session, we're gonna start off just kind of introducing where we all work. You heard a little bit about us. We're gonna introduce a little bit about where we work and tell you a little bit about, I'll show you a video actually on food councils, a quick 3-minute video. And then we're going to walk through a bit of this toolkit and tell you what it is, and then tell you about a case study of the Columbia Food Policy Committee who used this toolkit to organize a series of community food gatherings across their community. And then we'll share a little bit about food council development in general in the Carolinas, where things are at, what's happening, and then we'll have some time for Q&A at the end. So again, my name is Jared Cates. I'm based in North Carolina in Orange County. I work for an organization called the Carolina Farm Stewardship Association, who actually serves North and South Carolina. We have a network of sustainable farmers. Please check us out online. But I'm part of the Community Food Strategies team, which is a inter-agency, inter-organizational collaborative in North Carolina, made up of 6 organizations, 9 team members across the areas of policy, racial equity, health, sustainable ag, rural communities, hunger, and evaluation. And we support the network of food councils that is growing in North Carolina. So I'll hand it off to Zach and Ashley to introduce themselves.
Thanks, Jared. My name is Zach Hernstadt. I am based in Columbia, South Carolina. And Ashley and I are both part of the University of South Carolina's SNAP Ed team, which is housed in the Arnold School of Public Health. And I'm sure a lot of you know, are familiar with SNAP and the acronym, but that stands for the Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program, which is administered through the USDA. We are one of 4 SNAP Ed implementing agencies in South Carolina, which all work towards improving the likelihood that persons eligible for SNAP will make healthy food choices within a limited budget and also choose physically active lifestyles. Here at SNAP Ed, at U of SC SNAP Ed, we currently are focused on 6 different projects. The first project is working to implement PSE strategies. It's another acronym, but policy systems and environmental change strategies at libraries. I'll let Ashley talk briefly about that in a second, because that's one of her areas. We also work to implement PSE strategies at healthcare facilities. We are focused on food share expansion as well. And for those of you that don't know, food share primarily functions as a fresh food box program that also accepts SNAP benefits. And we're just working to replicate that, that food share model in different parts of the state. We also work on implementing transportation PSE strategies. We conduct statewide evaluations. And last but not least, we also work on food council development and expansion. And so I will turn it over to Ashley to introduce herself and the work that she does.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank y'all and eSmart Move More for having us this afternoon, and glad to be a part of the SNAP-Ed team over at University of South Carolina. So I feel like I'm the one that gets to wear multiple hats, but I love all of the hats that I get to wear, doing some food policy council work with Zach, doing library work, so doing strategies from helping folks set up maybe a garden, a farmer's market, a food pantry, now with some seed libraries. You want to be a summer meals program site, helping with that too, and also get to do some pretty cool community gardening work in the lower part of the Midlands as well. So it's been pretty cool being a part of the SNAP-Ed team, but today for this focus, we'll be talking about food policy councils.
Nice. So yeah, y'all are a huge resource on all the things related in South Carolina. So connect with Ashley and Zach if you have not connected with them. So I'm gonna stop sharing my screen for a second and then reshare it so we can hear some audio. But we're gonna hear we're gonna hear for a few minutes about, you know, what are food councils? So, you know, we talked about the support that we're providing in both in North and South Carolina for food councils. So what are these groups? Typically, they are groups that are gathering information, connecting people, educating people, and recommending changes around food systems, food policy work. So I'm going to show a 3-minute video from a North Carolina perspective of what food councils are. This is a video from 2019, so I apologize if you've seen it before, but it gives a good quick introduction to the framework of food councils. So here we go.
After being part of a food council, I have learned that food can be a really powerful tool for change, and it's not the only tool for change.
In general, people are not thinking about food as something to organize around and to create policy around and to create education around. And the idea of food and how it is a tool for doing good in the world and making the world better.
Our mission is to have a thriving local food system. And in that, a local food system means food access, healthy food grown, as well as even food waste.
So I see us as being a kind of a center clearinghouse for all of these different things that are going on in the community related to local food. We are sort of the node that connects them, and so we're a communication channel. We coordinate meetings so that people who will be useful to each other have a chance to meet. And we sort of keep our finger on the pulse of things that are going to affect local food, like policy items.
We're interested to do this work collectively across the community, knowing that race and place really determine our access to outcomes in the food system. Our access to food, our access to land ownership, our access to strong jobs.
It provides opportunity for individuals to have a space to discuss food issues. Oftentimes, community members don't have those spaces, so creating a time and a space for those conversations to happen, I mean, I think that that's key for food councils.
Food councils are community coalitions that are intentionally cross-sector, so a group of people that come together with different perspectives, different passions, with the intention of understanding and affecting change in their food system.
So a food council is kind of a way to connect all of the different moving pieces in a food system. So we've got everyone from farmers and other food producers to distributors and retailers like restaurant owners, grocery store owners, and also just the people who eat the food.
So it's a complete cycle of where the food comes from, where the food goes, and then where the food ends.
Food councils in general really can be a place where community members can have their voices heard and hopefully work with a group, this food council, to improve the conditions in their city or in their town.
This is about equity. And we want to understand the role that race and place plays in the outcomes that we have so that we can embed that knowledge into the policies that we develop.
It can be overwhelming to think about all the information that you can get.
Surmounting the obstacles has to be a group effort so that one person cannot. There's no way. You have to work with other people and you have to find allies, I guess, or people who understand the complexity of the situation.
All right, so you heard a lot about bringing people together, creating equitable food systems, creating community space. And how do you do that in a way that is authentic and create space for everyone to be part of these groups called food councils? And so that's one reason why we've created this toolkit, and we're here to chat with you all today. So I'm going to hand it over to Zach, who's going to talk a little bit about this toolkit to help food councils and others convene people.
Thanks, Jared. So before we get into the meat of the toolkit, I just wanted to provide a little bit of context for how this this toolkit came to be. Community Food Strategies originally developed the toolkit in 2018. And a bit after the toolkit was developed, a coalition of nonprofits in South Carolina received a Healthy Insights grant from the South Carolina Association for Community Economic Development to hold some community food gatherings and to document that process by developing a food forum toolkit, which could then be used to hold additional gatherings throughout the state of South Carolina. After receiving the grant, we discovered the great toolkit that Community Food Strategies had already developed. And so we approached them with the possibility of collaborating on updating their existing toolkit by incorporating some of the experiences and some of the lessons that we learned from the food gatherings that we held in Columbia, South Carolina. So we're really excited to be able to share this updated toolkit with you, which is the result of that collaboration. So I am going to provide a brief introduction of the toolkit itself. And then as Jared mentioned, Ashley will share a bit about our experience here in Columbia holding some community food gatherings. Next slide, please. So as you can see, the toolkit's broken up into five major sections. We have an introduction, which is what we're going to look through today. We have a planning section, which is essentially all the activities, all the considerations that take place leading up to the community food gathering, the event itself. Then we have the day of the event, and following that, how to keep the momentum going after the event has taken place. And then we thought it made sense to add an additional section focusing on tips for holding a virtual event. These community food gatherings were originally developed with the idea of holding them in person. Obviously with the pandemic over the past year and a half, a lot of that has had to change. And so we thought that it made a lot of sense to provide some tips on that option as well of going virtual. So again, the toolkit begins by setting the stage by introducing concepts like food councils, which we saw that great video which did that for us. But I also wanted to provide you with a little bit of an idea of what community food gatherings are. Ashley will go further into it. But for the sake of clarity, community food gatherings are really a specific type of public forum that bring people together to share a meal and then also to discuss concerns and solutions to creating a healthier food environment. The other thing that I wanted to emphasize is that while the toolkit really focuses on food councils as that as the host for food gatherings, that isn't to say that other community groups couldn't hold them as well, and we would hope that they would hold them as well. So another area of focus in this toolkit is really emphasizing that in a lot of ways, holding a community food gathering is is the culmination of months, sometimes years, of relationship building that happened before you even start planning for the food gathering itself. So you know that means having authentic conversations, creating and fostering relationships, and really that continual engagement with community members. All these things are really vital to the success of any food council. And that's why it's so important, and we really emphasize in the toolkit, especially the intro of the toolkit, that it's so important to really start with and then continue to center the work of relationship building to engage community members and to keep them engaged. And so we really encourage groups to have established some of those individual relationships with community members prior to planning for and definitely prior to holding a community food gathering. And now that being said, one of the biggest challenges that we hear from food councils and actually, you know from experience, it can be really challenging starting and sustaining a food council that also ensures that the voices of community members that are directly impacted by the inequities that are built into our food system are driving the council's programmatic and policy recommendations. And that really takes us to our next slide, which talks about minimizing barriers to participation. One of the reasons that councils might run into challenges in gaining that input and gaining that community involvement is that they might not have done the work that's necessary to minimize those barriers to participation. And so we thought it was really important to highlight some potential strategies to make these events, these food gatherings, more accessible to a wider group of community members. And when Ashley talks about our food gatherings that we held in Columbia, you're gonna see a lot of these bullet points that you see on the slide, these examples of how we did this, you know, but I'm just gonna go over a couple while we have this slide up. So really, minimizing barriers is a way of creating a welcoming, safe space for honest conversations among community members, which is really what the whole purpose of the food gathering is. So whether you're hosting virtual meetings, whether you're hosting in-person meetings that are, you know, near public transportation lines so that transportation needs are addressed, whether you're working to create a child-friendly environment, whether you're offering translation services, all these things are just so important to gaining that wider group of community member involvement. And so we also have some additional support materials around planning a food gathering. And so in addition to this toolkit, Community Food Strategies has developed some other really terrific toolkits focused on food council development, also focused on food councils hosting candidate forums. So be sure to check those out. We also created a worksheet that will help guide you through the planning process of holding a community food gathering. If you need a little bit more structure, we highly encourage you to check that out as well. It really does a good job accompanying this toolkit itself. So I am going to pass it on to Ashley now, who is going to talk through our experience here in Columbia of holding a series of community food gatherings in 2019.
All right, there we go, there we go. So I will say kind of before, I think Zach set this up perfectly. So I will tell you all kind of a little background about the Columbia Food Policy Committee. We're a municipal model. So there are different types of models. It may be a grassroots or nonprofit, but a municipal model means that all of our members have been appointed by our mayor and city council. So we got back started in 2017 and we had 20 members. And we've noticed when we looked around the table, my little new phrase is that we saw its comma blank, blank, blank behind their names were all the folks at the table. Nothing is wrong with you earning your degrees and you getting that knowledge, but if we could be real, it also allows you a certain privilege, or maybe you don't have certain experiences that aren't the full representation of your community. And so when we realized that, we said, we really need to do some work, and it shouldn't just be a group of 20 folks with that comma blank, blank, blank behind their name, coming up with policy recommendations that may have huge impacts for communities maybe we don't even live in. And so we had to kind of take a step back. So we were in our early process, and when we developed our subcommittees, we started a food equity subcommittee. So we were very early on grounded in making sure that we heard from community members, that we wanted that to be a priority. And so that's kind of where we put this community food gathering process. So I wanted to kind of give some background framing to why we really were so motivated in making sure that we did this with some really good diligence and being very thorough. So this process was not like a month or 2 months or 3 months. This process, probably from start to finish, took us about a year and a half, because we wanted to make sure that we really did this process right. And so I'll kind of talk some about before, but I want to also highlight, as you see on the right hand, talking about where we held these. And so if you're familiar with Columbia, you may have heard of some of our zip codes that are kind of our lower food access areas, which are 29203 and 29204. And so we really wanted to make sure that we focus on areas. If we're talking about policy and programmatic recommendations, we wanted to make sure we went directly to the most impacted community. So as you can see, we had 5 food gatherings within those zip codes. And so for folks who know about Columbia, kind of where those zip codes are located, are kind of more of the north side of Columbia, what we frame to as North Columbia. And so as you kind of can see, you know, again, the key reasons for was really to make sure that we had folks who were going to be directly impacted being in the driver's seat. And so kind of before in Columbia, we've had some instances where we've tried to do some things. So think about that. We're not even a year in for our food policy committee, and we already kind of were brought into a situation where the city were looking at doing some things. And we kind of learned early on, you can't ask folks their opinion once the bus has already left the station. Get people on the station first, get them to buy in, then let's go and move to our destination. So we really wanted to make sure that we did that process the right way. And so just want to take a special note at the bottom to thank some important folks that without them, we wouldn't have made this happen. Benita Clemens and Keith Alexander. So Benita did some wonderful food for us for all of the food gatherings, and Keith helped out in his special way. Also Central Midlands Development Corporation and COG. And so Gregory was a huge help with this process. Food Share South Carolina. So we gave folks those produce boxes, the Midlands Food Alliance, and Zach said earlier, SCASIC. And so kind of when you think about, you know, a community food gathering, I love to say we had all these lovely food policy committee meetings and we never had food. I don't understand how we can talk about food and making change and we never ate together. So we said we're going to make sure that we provide folks a really good meal, and not just a good meal, but I think also trying to, you know, we're not just talking about food access, but we try to preface that by saying healthy food access. And so we wanted it to be a healthy meal. So you had, you know, those vegetables and, you know, for folks who are vegetarian or vegan, you know, we had, you know, produce offerings and grain offerings, but we also had, you know, chicken. So a nice leaner meat. Also, so a lot of that produce was locally sourced. And also we were trying to be very mindful about whom we employed, because through the grant, we were able to hire folks to do certain services. So we wanted to be very mindful. Typically, when you have a lot of these opportunities, folks who look like me and who are women get overlooked for those opportunities. And so we want to be very respectful of that and some of the values that we set early on through our food policy committee. So we hired an African-American female entrepreneur to be able to do healthy food for these. So we had that meal. Then we kind of had that welcome and introduction just to kind of set the place of the event. Then we kind of had that small group dialogue, you know, had that group, had the kind of those intimate settings where we had kind of a facilitator and a note taker in that session to capture the essence of those sessions. And then kind of that report out style, allowing kind of, you know, someone or a reporter from those groups to be able to share the conversation from those groups. And so here are just some of the questions that we ask for our food gathering process. What does the food environment currently look like in your community? What are the barriers or problems you face when it comes to accessing food? And what do you want to see happen in order to make easier to access food? So those were kind of a lot of the questions. And as you can imagine, those were enough for the time frame we had, which was about an hour and a half, 2 hours, because folks went on and on about all kind of great things that they wanted to see. And also some talking about the real challenges that folks faced, that maybe folks, maybe you knew, maybe data showed, but a lot of times, you know, hearing from those individual personal experiences by folks were really powerful. And then also, of course, you know, we had those three main questions, but of course, you know, Jared shared that wonderful video. The food system is so wide and it's such a breadth to the food system. So of course, we don't want you to think that you have to limit, if you want to replicate this process, you just have to limit it to those three questions, but there are other areas that you can capture kind of some of those additional general questions. If you want to know more information about your production industry and your local food system, about those processing industries. So we know, you know, we're working with the community in the upper part of the state, and that's a big item right now. And so folks, if y'all remember, because of COVID, the chicken processing plants, it was huge troubles there. And so, you know, that may be an issue that it's prominent and you all need to discuss for your community. Even talking about, you know, distribution, that was another thing that we heard about due to COVID that really came up. We know food access is a challenge for many communities. And so those are some additional questions around that. Even, you know, consumption. So trying to figure out, you know, where do you purchase your fruit from? And also talking about that food waste component as well. And so kind of what did this almost a year and a half process lead us to? So after we did those five gatherings in those neighborhood communities, we had a culminating event. So Zach mentioned Food Share. So we went over to the Food Share Hub. They thankfully welcomed us to do that process there. Again, we fed people. We had Food Share boxes for folks to take home. We had those lovely child-friendly activities, and we gave folks their power. So hearing all that information, that Food Equity Subcommittee, they did a lot of hard work during this year and a half process. And they kind of, as you can see, kind of those whiteboard papers, and they kind of synthesized some of the highlights from all of the five food gatherings that we held. And so we gave folks the power to vote with a little yellow sticky dot. So we gave them yellow sticky dots. They would peel it off that paper and they would walk around to the various whiteboard setups that we had. That talked about kind of what we kind of came in and framed it into different issue areas and voted with those yellow dots. And so kind of once we synthesized the data, those that had the most yellow dots, that is kind of how we went and summed up our process. So kind of where this information is now, you know, as you can imagine, the number one thing folks cared about was healthy food access. So we kind of summed it up in five areas down to issue area number five, or we frame it as aspiration number five, is talking about transportation access. And so where we are now, December 2019, we presented this to City Council. They approved unanimously all five of our aspirational areas. We did this lovely strategic planning session and then COVID hit. So we did a lot of great COVID work, but we are now starting to work into that plan that the community really spearheaded to lead, coming up with those recommendations. And I will say, because many communities have a great opportunity with American Rescue plan funding. That is something. Yesterday we had our monthly meeting and we are working on recommendations for that 25 million City of Columbia and 80 million Richland County are going to get. So I would encourage you, if you're in your community, have those conversations with your city officials, your county officials, to find out what their plans are. And so we did find out yesterday that City of Columbia is recommending 5 priority areas, and we're thankful that food did make the cut into one of those 5 priority areas. So we're certainly going to ask for some much needed funding support to go to a lot of good work in the community. But for next steps, of course, you know, research existing policies and in other communities, other best practices, you know, develop your education materials so you can present those policy recommendations, one, to community members. So we did send it out to folks who were a part of that food gathering process, as well as members of council. You know, also start a public outreach campaign. So ask those who participated and your friends, family, coworkers, you know, follow up and email your city councilman, call them, say, hey, we know we're aware that you got these policy recommendations. We ask that you take action and don't just have them on paper, but how can we move that forward into implemented policy? And again, continue to meet with relevant, you know, elected officials, even from a city, county, all the way to a state level, to move this work forward.
Awesome. Thanks, Ashley. And I can imagine that's frustrating, like, to have the, you know, COVID being a glitch in y'all's process, but I can imagine, like, having just gone through that, y'all were probably much stronger and well-positioned to handle COVID after mm-hmm. having that network kind of develop right beforehand. Is that a good guess?
It is. We even formed a whole subcommittee nice. From this. So committee now, so definitely has there been helpful.
Go. There you go. Well, awesome. Well, great. Well, I'm gonna go back. So the process that was used and the process that this toolkit lays out is this kind of, you know, Zach kind of talked about before, but the planning process is this one. It's kind of like form a leadership team, create an evaluation plan, identify your partners, design an agenda, design your event, develop a budget, you know, develop your promotion strategy, get your volunteers. And, you know, it's like pretty basic steps that anyone thinks about when hosting an event. But this toolkit, you know, was designed with input from Columbia and folks who did these meetings and it's updated with that input. And so we're really excited and hope that this is a tool that is useful for folks as we all come out of COVID and are hopefully planning to do more in-person events. So thanks, Zach and Ashley. So we have a few minutes left before we get into questions. But we wanted to just share some quick updates on the food councils in both states. So in North Carolina, there are about 32 food councils now. That similar to how Ashley said, you know, Columbia is a city sanctioned group. In North Carolina, these are a variety of groups from grassroots to 501c3s. There's a couple that are in city and county government. And then you can see where there's those lines. There's a few regional ones that are popping up now. There's an official regional one around the triad in North Carolina. So those, the network in North Carolina continues to kind of evolve and is taking on more and more kind of policy work. Right now they're doing exactly what Ashley's talking about, trying to talk about ARP and how they can leverage those funds locally and how they can kind of support each other in talking about that and sharing ideas and getting their counties to talk to each other. So yes, it seems to be an exciting time in food systems work with everyone realizing, hey, we gotta feed ourselves during times of emergency. This is the thing we need to pay attention to. But at Community Food Strategies this year, we're kind of supporting that network in several different ways. And we're doing that with monthly food council connection calls where the food councils across the state can join. We'd love for any South Carolina councils to join. There's usually some upstate folks that kind of align with the Charlotte group. And so they usually come and hang out. Anyone from South Carolina is welcome to come. And then we're doing Facebook Lives once a month on Fridays, featuring food policy councils and then also groups engaging in food policy to talk about the advocacy that they're doing, to just update the network on, like, you know, how are food councils engaging in policy? How are they doing it locally and collaboratively? And then what are some groups that they can connect with if they're trying to advocate for certain issues? And then we're also doing a food policy and organizing series this year, which is really exciting. And we have a cohort of 20 food council folks who have applied and representing 10 councils that are going through a series of 4 trainings this year, all about food policy organizing and advocacy. So we're really excited to work with that cohort this year and learn together. And then one last thing, in North Carolina, we've really shifted to, I think, you know, Zach and Ashley will share about some funding that they've gotten for their network, for the network in South Carolina. But in North Carolina, we're really trying to shift towards a shared gifting model with food councils. And so as Community Food Strategies, we've been fundraising and we've used that funds we raised last year to do a shared gifting process, which was about $100,000 given out to food councils across different regions. And there was two food councils from South Carolina that participated in the Charlotte Gifting Circle, Spartanburg and Catawba. In this process, food councils get to decide themselves who in their region gets this money. There's a certain pot for the region. They pitch projects to each other. It's trying to be done in an equitable way. It's all about building relationships and helping people invest where they see is best in their region. So it was a very exploratory process for us, and we're trying to do that again this year. We're trying to fundraise to do that. But we're excited to share about that process if anyone else is interested in learning about shared gifting. So that's what's happening in North Carolina, and I'll pass it over to Zach and Ashley.
Thanks, Jared. So there's a lot of exciting stuff as you can see going on in North Carolina, and we in South Carolina are also working to really ramp up our network of local food policy councils. We're excited to have just awarded local seven amazing communities in South Carolina with the Local Food Policy Council Development and Expansion Grant. And one thing we know from the literature on existing food councils is that a lack of funding to compensate staff time can really be a huge barrier for ramping up local food council activities. And so what we tried to do through these grants, which are funded through SNAP-Ed, is to provide funding for some staff time for these newly forming food councils to accelerate their development, and then but also for any existing councils that are involved to expand that capacity to really identify those PSE strategies for improving healthy food access, and also ensuring food equity is extremely important part of it. So the next slide shows the seven communities that we're working with, or fortunate enough to work with. And as you can see, it's kind of a mixture. We have some cities and towns. We have individual counties. We have one tri-county area that's kind of joining forces and working towards this local food policy council development. And from our end at U of SC SNAP-Ed, we are providing them with ongoing training and technical assistance through a variety of different strategies. One, we're holding monthly learning collaborative calls, similar to what is going on in North Carolina. And we're really hoping that these calls and this interaction, this regular interaction develops into really a cohort of food councils that are learning together and from each other, and also sharing best practices, discussing, you know, any roadblocks that they're encountering as they move forward. We're also providing trainings on how to start and sustain food councils, really focused on food councils rooted in equity and inclusion, and making sure that community members are a part of that process. We're also providing guidance on some best practices for starting up a council. Conducting community food assessments is one of those, and also holding community food gatherings. So we are also very excited about this toolkit because we will be sharing it with our councils moving forward, and it's going to be a huge help. From those food gatherings, from those community food assessments, from that input from the community, we're then working towards identifying those strategic areas of focus and those policy recommendations that Ashley kind of alluded to for Columbia, but working with other communities to form those recommendations, and then providing suggestions for implementation strategies as well. And so this is really, we just started work with this initial cohort about a month ago. And so we're really excited to see what happens and move forward and really learning from the amazing work that Jared and his colleagues do in North Carolina and really are aspiring to kind of create a robust network like they have up in North Carolina, down here in South Carolina as well. And I'll go ahead and pass it on to Ashley for any final thoughts that she has before we move to questions.
Well, I will say, you may be looking and say, well, my community was not listed, or you may say, I live in one of those communities. So you do have our emails. Also, just because Jared is in North Carolina, he is a huge resource. I would encourage you all to also reach out to Jared, but I will say we are also ramping up our state level South Carolina Food Policy Council. So we do have a state level Food Policy Council, and recently we did create a free general membership. So if you're an individual and you say, hey, I just want to get involved, my county may not be listed, but I want to get involved at a state level, you can certainly join. Just go to the State Food Policy Council website, so South Carolina, Zach, I think it was South Carolina SC. You may have to put that in the chat, or we might have to give it to Phil to send to folks, but certainly that is something that folks can do and be a part of those quarterly membership conversations as well.
Yeah, it's scfoodpolicy.org is the website. You can also just Google it. If you just put in South Carolina Food Policy Council, it'll hopefully show up near the top.
Nice. Yeah, thanks y'all. And I just have to say, like, I think it's just always been such a pleasure to see folks across the Carolinas working together on these issues and trying to support communities across both of our states. So this is just working with you all on this opportunity has just been so fantastic. And we've learned so much from y'all, and just so excited to see this, you know, network of local groups grow across both states. We have the first bill in North Carolina this year that is put forward by food councils. Food councils put forward a bill of asking for a budget allocation, and they got some folks to lobby with them, and they're asking for $50,000 for some resources that are needed throughout the state. And so, like, I think that is like a amazing like kind of milestone, and hopefully we see more of that across both states. So excited to continue that work with y'all. And I'm gonna stop sharing my screen and maybe open it up for questions with Phil, and I might have a link to the toolkit that I'll share with Phil that he can drop in for y'all and open it up for questions.
Yeah, thank y'all so much. This is so great. I am always honored to be on the line with y'all and serving on the South Carolina Food Policy Council with you all. We do have one question already. For the folks who are watching us online, please put those questions in the Q&A section on the right side of your screen. But the first question we have, and I can kind of answer this too once y'all take a first stab at it. Will a copy of the presentation be available as a resource to plan and host an event?
Yes, and many of the slides that we shared are actually from the toolkit itself. So we shared that link, and we can share the slides as well.
Great. And for folks on that have registered for the summit, this presentation will be available for 6 months on this webpage. So you can watch it as many times as you want to, share it with all of your community members. And I am copying and pasting these links that Jared has put in the chat here. So bear with me. For those that know me, I have blonde hair. I'm not talking about all blondes here, but I can only do so many things at once. So bear with me. All right. I've got the first link in the chat for the folks watching.
And that first link, the website, it lives live on the Community Food Strategies website, and also from the presentation, you can see the other link. It's on the USC website as well. So we're excited to share that out through both states.
All right, let's see. Any more questions coming through? Not yet. No, I'm just so excited. I know y'all, I'm in Orangeburg. So I absolutely love to see Orangeburg, Calhoun, and Bierenberg counties being part of the focus here. So with y'all's expertise, I think we're gonna make some changes around the state, which I'm super, super pumped for.
Yeah, we're really fortunate to be working with some great people out of Orangeburg and in the surrounding counties. And it's already been a real, just a treat to work with them there. They definitely are heading in an exciting direction. I know Ashley has had some connections with them in the past as well through growing Cobb.
Yeah, Ashley and I go back a little further than my time with the council, applying for the first grant for growing Cobb together in the county administration building. So that was some fun. But I don't see, we'll stay on just for a few more minutes and spill the tea and have some fun until we either get some more questions or feel that we have spilled enough tea. I'm just one last housekeeping item for folks. Please fill out the evaluation at the end. This session is, you're eligible for social work, CHES and MCHES. So that is exciting. This is the first one that I see all three. So please be sure to fill out the evaluation. Is there anything else that y'all wanna share before we hop on to our, I think we have a music and trivia break next for some door prizes. I'm hoping they play my hype song.
Well, thanks so much for having us, Bill.
Absolutely.
Yeah, we really appreciate the opportunity. And yeah, for us, it's just like Jared said, it's really, it's fun to get to talk about food policy councils from a, you know, from a perspective of North and South Carolina working together. And so we're really optimistic about what the next few years have to hold.